Good evening, and welcome to the Henry Schein Dental Academy webinar series. My name is Adam, Marketing Specialist, and I'll be your moderator. Tonight, we're welcoming Dr. Michael Young as our speaker, as he will outline the benefits of and best practices for an all-digital guided implant workflow using custom abutments and crown design files from TruAbutment. Before I hand it off to Dr. Young, we have a few reminders for you. At any point during the webinar, if you do have a question, please type it into the Q&A section of your control panel and we'll email you back within 2 business days. Henry Schein is not offering CE credit for viewing or attending this presentation live or on demand, and this webinar is sponsored by Plan Mecca Fit. Dr. Young, thanks for joining us tonight.
Thanks, Adam. Hello and welcome to this webinar, How to Use CAD/CAM and TruAbutment for Predictable Guided Implant Restoration Outcomes. For those that don't know me, I am a 1994 graduate of the University of Michigan School of Dentistry. I have a private practice in Sterling Heights, Michigan. I've been a mentor for the Coy Center since 2005. This is part of the swim course for the St. Anthony's Triathlon in St. Pete's, Florida. I've done a few long distance events with some friends to raise money to find a cure for blood cancer. This is my blended family. We call it the Party of Eight. It's Mike and Cheryl instead of Mike and Carol. We've got 3 girls, 3 boys, 2 dogs, and unfortunately no Alice. This picture was taken in the summer of 2019. And since then, 3 of these kids have gone off to college and the oldest has finished her 2nd year already. These are the 2 dogs, Brody on the left, Callie on the right, guardians of the yard, protectors of all of us. And this is Sparty, my favorite mascot and representative of my favorite university, Michigan State. This is my digital dental journey. I started with digital dentistry in 2004 with CEREC RedCam because I wanted to do conservative, minimally invasive restorations in one visit, and that's kind of hard to do with a temporary. So that's the reason for the one visit. CAD/CAM just solves that problem. And of course, we need upgrades with new software, new camera, new milling unit. In 2013, I switched to E4D. Had the cart for about a month or so before the Nico laptop came out. And then on the plan scan. In 2015, I upgraded my pan set machine to 3D. And at the end of 2017, I made a huge change in my practice by putting in 3D printing and adding the Emerald scanner. The combination gave me access to a lot of workflows and the Emerald S, which is my current scanner. And last summer I had to upgrade or change my 3D printer. And the funny thing is, anybody who's bought technology knows that there is no endpoint to your purchasing. So full disclosure, I am a member of the Plan Mecca Board of Education and I'm a KOL. I am not being compensated in any way by Plan Mecca for this webinar. And while I use Plan Mecca technology, and you're gonna see that during the webinar, that's not the take home message. The important part of this is just the digital workflow in general and how it works for planning implants, placing implants, and restoring implants, especially with TruAbutment. You can use other technology, you can use other software. The most important part is that your software can import and export files. So our objectives for tonight, I'm gonna show you a prosthetically driven digital implant planning workflow. I'm gonna show you evidence for guided placement, evidence for screw retained or screw-mentable restorations, the scanning protocol for TruAbutment, and file transfer and feedback loop with TruAbutment. And of course, milling and the final delivery. So this study from 2004 from Bucer is a little bit of an exaggeration here, right? We don't really need a study for this, but they said that placement of implants in a correct 3-dimensional position is a key to an aesthetic treatment outcome, regardless of the implant system use. I don't know about you, but I don't really want to have to restore that and be expected to have a great outcome. So this is a 2D PA of an implant placed, and it looks pretty good. And this has been really the standard. But what if we look at this from a different point of view? A 3D image shows quite a different story. This study from Eunice that was published in 2018, a randomized controlled study on the accuracy of free-handed pilot drill guided and fully guided implant surgery in partially edentulous patients. What they were measuring was the apical global deviation, which you saw in that movement of the implant there. And what the results were, in the freehand, the mean deviation was 2.11 millimeters, but the maximum was 4.84. For the pilot drill guided, the mean was 1.43 and the maximum 2.72. Fully guided was 0.97 and the maximum was 1.98. Now 2.11 millimeters might not seem like much, but it could make a difference on where the screw access hole is and whether we can actually have a screw access hole at all. So the conclusion is, when perfect implant positioning is required, fully guided surgery should be considered the gold standard approach. Furthermore, although screw retained restorations were planned for all the implants in this study, 19.2% in the freehand group received a cement restoration. Results were better for the pilot guided, as only 4.2 needed a cement retained restoration, but fully guided, 100% of the placed implants received a screw retained restoration. Here's another study, this one by Arasan et al. In the International Journal of Oral Maxillofacial Implants, published in 2013, looked at positioning errors in freehand and computer-aided placement of multiple implants in edentulous jaws. They placed 353 implants in 54 patients, and they found that interproximal emergence, inner implant distance, and parallelism errors were significantly higher in implants placed by the freehand method. The highest probability positioning error was associated with the use of the freehand method, and it's really not even close. The idea from this slide I borrowed from a friend, Dr. Wally Renee, but I added a little twist. It's a no-brainer. I don't really want to use my brain for this. So this study wanted to determine the profiles for patient-based risk assessment and diagnostics of plaque-induced, surgically and prosthetically triggered peri-implantitis. According to this study, the trigger for peri-implantitis was surgical 41% of the time, prosthetic 30% of the time, and plaque-induced 29% of the time. Let's look at the restorative. Peri-implantitis is a site-specific infectious disease that causes an inflammatory process in soft tissues and bone loss around an osseointegrated implant in function. It can result in bone loss around the implant and eventual loss of the implant. This study from Wilson, the positive relationship between excess cement and peri-implant disease, a prospective clinical endoscopic study. Cement retained restorations are commonly used on dental implants. Residual excess cement after placement of fixed partial dentures has been associated with clinical and radiographic signs of peri-implant disease. The purpose of the study was to explore the relationship between excess dental cement and peri-implant disease using the dental endoscope. Their conclusions were, excess dental cement was associated with signs of peri-implant disease in the majority of the cases. Clinical and endoscopic signs of peri-implant disease were absent in 74% of the test implants after the removal of excess cement. This study, the impact of residual subgingival cement on biological complications around dental implants, was a systematic review. Their conclusion was residual subgingival cement seems to be strongly associated with peri-implant mucositis, which is a risk factor for increased probing depths, crestal bone loss, and peri-implantitis. This study from Linkovicius et al. Does residual cement around implant-supported restorations cause peri-implant disease. This was a retrospective case analysis. And the objectives of the study was to determine the relationship between patients with a history of periodontitis and development of cement-related peri-implant disease. Results of this study show peri-implantitis occurred 85% of the time if there were cement remnants. For those with a history of periodontal disease, peri-implantitis occurred 100% of the time when cement remnants were present. When there's no history of periodontal disease, peri-implantitis still occurred 65% of the time when cement was left behind. When there was no history of periodontal disease, peri-implantitis still occurred 30% of the time with no presence of cement remnants, which we might expect since we saw the study that said it can be surgically or plaque-induced. This last graph is key for me. Screw-retained restorations has almost no peri-implantitis, only 1%, and at least in those without a history of periodontal disease. I'm looking for predictability and low risk. So their conclusion, implants with cement remnants in patients with history of periodontitis may be more likely to develop peri-implantitis compared with patients without history of periodontal infection. Here's another study from Linkovicius et al. The influence of cementation margin position on the amount of undetected cement. It was a prospective clinical study. And their objective was to evaluate the amount of undetected cement after cementation and cleaning of implant-supported restorations. They had 53 patients with 53 single implant-supported metal ceramic restorations. And the subgingival location of the margin of each implant was measured and probed mesially, distally, buccally, and lingually. The data was divided into four groups equally, with tissue level 1 millimeter subgingivally, 2 millimeters, and 3 millimeters below tissue contour. Metal ceramic restorations were fabricated with occlusal openings and cemented on standard abutments with resin reinforced glass ionomer. After cleaning, a radiograph was taken to assess if all cement had been removed. Then the abutment crown was unscrewed for evaluation. All quadrants of the specimens and peri-implant tissues were photographed and analyzed with Adobe Photoshop. The results. The deeper the position of the margin, the greater amount of undetected cement was discovered. They found that dental radiographs should not be considered as a reliable method for cement excess evaluation. This study, cement or clinical factors influencing removal of the cement excess in implant-supported restorations. The depth of the cementation margin has an influence on the amount of cement remnants around implants. However, the role of other clinical factors is still not clarified. So the purpose of this study was to evaluate the correlation between undetected cement and location of the implant, implant diameter, and undercut. They had 65 patients with single metal ceramic restorations on implants. The undercut between the restoration and the tissue was measured, and after cementation, the restoration abutment unit was unscrewed. All quadrants of the specimens were photographed and analyzed. And what they found was that if a cement crown restoration is desired, undercuts should be reduced to a minimum for better removal of cement excess, irrespective of the diameter and location of the implants. So bottom line, the three-dimensional position of the implant is critical for aesthetics. It's critical for healthy, hard, and soft tissue and long-term prognosis. Personally, I want predictability and low risk. So I'm gonna get a 3D scan. I'm gonna take an intraoral scan. I'm gonna plan the surgery on a computer, 3D print a model, a surgical guide, excuse me, and I'm gonna fully guide, place my implants. I also want a screw-retained restoration that I can cement in my hands. This eliminates the risk of residual cement. I don't want deep margins or undercuts. I'm more predictable, low risk. So that used to be what I would do. I would totally lose all control of the case, refer the patient out, wait for everything, and wonder what happened. Every once in a while, a patient's name would pop in my head. I wonder what happened to so-and-so. Doesn't make a lot of sense. And then on top of that, this is what it would cost. I would pay $125 for an online meeting with a technician to plan the implant placement. I paid $135 for the surgical guide, $50 for a sleeve, $25 for a stone model, which makes no sense because we're doing 3D printing. Shipping and handling, $13, tax $13.38, and a refund for my wasted time of zero. $361.38. So with coronavirus and the pandemic, we know from recent studies that 65% of us are not seeing the same patient volume. We have to maximize our appointments that we do have. And what do you think patients prefer? Do they want to go somewhere else? Do they want to wait? Everyone wants everything right now. And it's not a good business strategy to refer your patient somewhere else to an imaging center if you can avoid it. So this is my current digital dentistry puzzle, the Emerald S intraoral scanner, my original E4D mill from 2013, a ProMax Classic 3D cone beam, and my Sprint Ray Pro 3D printer. These pieces are what I call my digital dentistry puzzle. So in my practice, we can take digital impressions, we can take cone beams, we can 3D print, and we can mill. Now, depending on what pieces you have in your practice, what you want to delegate, what you just don't want to spend time doing, will determine which workflow you might use. For me, this is basically what I do all the time. It's all digital, it's fully guided, it's planned in my office on my software. The surgical guide is printed in the office, and then I send it to TruAbutment for a custom abutment and a crown design file. And they send it back and I mill it in the office. Let's take a look at that workflow. Now in my office, if I've got someone in my chair, a hygiene chair maybe, or they've come into my chair for an implant consult and we've got an edentulous space, we just take a cone beam. We have an ultra low dose with very low exposure. It's quick and easy to see if the patient is a good candidate. So we take the image and we take a look. Do we have bone? Now I'm sitting next to the patient. Now I've already taken the image. I go back to the room and I've got my laptop and I can just select an implant and put it right in the bone in the software. It's very powerful. And it's literally that fast. And if we've got enough bone, we take out the intraoral scanner and get an impression. Now, from that digital impression, we're going to design a crown. We want to begin with the end in mind. Warren Buffett said, an idiot with a plan can beat a genius without a plan. And the final vision, the restoration, should be the guide. Very simple crown design. Now this isn't the final restoration, this is just for the surgery. So now we have both of those 3D images and we're gonna fit them together. Inside of Remexus, this is really quite easy. There's a wizard that guides you along each step of the way. We're gonna find our intraoral scan to merge and click on it. Choose three corresponding points. That time I added an extra, make it fit a little bit better, and then it's a fine-tuned match algorithm in the software. We're going to check our fit. Now we're going to find the design crown. It's going to just snap right into place. Very, very easy. Now that we've got all the data merged, we're going to plan the implant based on that crown position. Of course, we have to respect where the bone is. Looks like I've got a screw access channel that's going to work really well. And that is so easy and so fast. And then right inside the module to the surgical guide design. This is something that's easily, it's something that you can easily delegate to a staff member. Of course, different implant systems will have different parameters you can change right in the software. Now we're just going to clean it up by removing some material. Create a few windows. Put the patient's name on there if you want. And then you're going to export it. And then from there, you can put it right into your 3D printer. And that's what that looks like. So that particular case here is the 3D image immediately after placement. Now it's integrated. We've waited 3 or 4 months and we're going to take our digital impression for our custom abutment. So far, this has been done with all the digital puzzle pieces in my office. And now it's time to introduce TruAbutment. So they have a pre-op tab where we've removed the healing abutment so we can get a scan of the tissue. And a scan body tab. We've copied the pre-op tab in there, erased where the scan body is gonna go, the scan body in and take a digital impression. And now we're gonna send the case to TruAbutment. And there's two ways to do that, depending on whether you have Romexis or other software. Just select my case and I export to desktop, make a folder. I have TruAbutment set up automatically to go. We're gonna click new scan file upload. And we're gonna make a pressed folder. And we're literally gonna drag and drop that right into the area there. Then we're gonna download the order form. It's a PDF fillable form. Put your date, office name, everything requested there, very simple. You're gonna check off what you're sending. Put your implant in, your tooth, platform, and your abutment type. I want a design confirmation email, so I put my email there. Select what you want for your parameters. And then a little note. In this case, we had a little special request, so we typed it in the bottom there. And I always ask for them to send me the crown design file so I can mill in my office. And now we're gonna save this. Patient's name at the beginning there. Goes to the desktop. We'll go back to the portal. Drag that little PDF right in there. And I put the note in there about the special request again. Make sure they didn't miss it. Click add to cart. Okay. And one more okay after the files upload. I'm sure, and a thank you. So that's if you don't have Romexis, whatever software you're using, as long as you get it to the desktop, you can drag the file over there and fill out the form. This would be if you have Romexis, there's a way to go right through the software. First, we're gonna create a lab order. The date that you want it back. You're gonna add a restoration. I'm gonna click on the tooth, select abutment, and then what type of implant we're using. We're going to select crown, ceramics, shade's really not critical because in my office we're going to mill it. We've already determined that. Now we've saved this lab order. Open the case and you'll see lab orders right down there. And then we click TruAbutment send. Very, very simple to do. And in about a day, this is an email I get. This is a confirmation email from the CAD Digital Design Center for TruAbutment. And you just scroll through the pictures, make sure it's the way you want it. And if so, you just ask them to proceed. And this was literally the same day that I said, yes, I confirm. I get an email right away saying, thank you for your confirmation. We'll proceed with the design. And they've attached the STL file. So now I literally can download these STL files to my desktop and mill the crown right then before I even have the abutment in my hand. And this is that case. You can see the abutment design where we place the margin and then the restoration. And now I have that file to import the crown into my software to mill. And this is what that looks like. In this case, I saved it to desktop. I really didn't need to. I could have left it in the download folder. We're going to hit import CAD/CAM STL for milling. Browse for the file, go to the desktop, click. There it is. Done. And in a few seconds, it magically appears exactly like that. So very important that I can import this because this really makes the whole case. There's the implant, there's the custom abutment, there's the final restoration. We really could have spent some time staining that, characterizing it, and improving the color. Patient doesn't really care. That's what it looks like from the occlusal. You can see the access opening is filled. So now this time, in-office planning workflow cost, planning and printing. So $0 to spend online planning. And this is the cost for a surgical guide resin. Now I took this from Formlab's website. And the first fee there is for exporting software out of Blue Sky Bio. And then the next two numbers are the cost of the resin. So by their estimate, it took me about $5.13 worth of resin to print that surgical guide. I only pay $7 for a sleeve, not 50. I didn't need a stone model. I don't print a 3D model. I don't have to ship it. There's no tax. I have not wasted any of my time. That cost me $12.13. So the difference in the two workflows is $349.25. Now I paid $4,500 for the software. So what that means in my case is that in less than 13 cases, the software has paid itself off, and now we're putting money from the right pocket into the left. And you might want to consider the cost of the printer too, so I just throw that in there. But the reality is the printer is doing so many other things in the office, like printing models and night guards and so forth. So it's hard to say what proportion goes to what, but that's the cost. So let's look at that in office versus outsourced planning cost, $12 versus $361. So now about the restoration. I don't know about you, but every time I try to take one of these, I have PVS all over my hands, all over the patient's face, especially with the open tray. We know that we need to remake impressions quite often. And then the milled custom abutment and crown cost me $517. So there was a savings about $300 per case. So how many implants you restore per month that were done by a specialist or whether you place implants or yourself. But if you do just one or two, that savings alone helps really pay for the mill. And so there's really not an excuse anymore not to have a mill. You don't have to worry about how many crowns you mill every month. We know that most of our impressions have a detectable error, and 55% in this study involved the finish line. But that's the kind of stuff we've been sending our labs. Now, this is a reference, intraoral scanners in dentistry. It was a review of the current literature. This was published in 2017, so it's extremely outdated by this particular time. But what they looked at was traditional versus digital impressions. They looked at pros and cons, the current scanners that were on the market, they looked at their accuracy and the different workflows that you could do with those scanners. And what they found so digital impressions reduce discomfort, simplify procedures, improve lab and patient communication, and they're just simply faster, better, and preferred. Look at that. How would you like to be sitting there with that throat? I've been moving calm, don't start no trouble with me.
Twine. All right, now bite down. And, oh,
okay. Breathe through your nose, right? My favorite's coming up. Don't panic. So for about 4.5 minutes, you're sitting there with that in your throat. Imagine that. And on top of that, there's a good chance you're gonna have an error anyway. We call that the platypus impression. Believe me, I've taken a few in my office. Another bonus with the digital impression is that you can see where you're missing data right away. You don't have to wait 4.5 minutes after you've removed the impression to find out that you've got an issue. You can see it on the screen and you can simply go back. Imagine telling the patient, guess what? We get to do this again. So the restoration with TruAbutment digital workflow. The scan body costs $25 and it's autoclavable. The milled titanium custom abutment and crown design file is $204. And the Emax block that I use is about $34 for a cost of $263. Pretty significant savings. So the planning and the guide and the restoration for in-office versus traditional. So let's say you don't have some of those pieces. Let's say you don't want to buy a 3D printer. Okay, that's fine. Maybe you don't even want the mill. That's good too. This is a case we did with TruAbutment, all digital fully guided, but TruAbutment co-planned it with me. They printed the surgical guide. They did the custom healing and final abutment and the crown design file. And if you don't have a milling unit, you could simply have them mill it or send it to a lab of your choice. But in this case, we milled it in office. So here's the scan of the arch. There's the cone beam. Now take note, this is in 3Shape software, but my files play nice with other software. Here's the crown design. Again, we're beginning with the end in mind. The cone beam. Gonna mark the panoramic curve and merge the files. Again, green is good. And we're going to mark the nerve, which in this case was really, really difficult. So we kind of made a worst case scenario. And there's the implant placed in the 3Shape software. The surgical guide. And then with each case you do, you get a drilling protocol, a PDF report. It's got the detailed drill length, sleeve height, offset, everything, just so that you can verify, and a surgical report. You also get this report, which I think is awesome. It's a step-by-step guide. It's your roadmap for placement. You follow along and you really can't mess this up. Now we're going to talk about fixture drill, the fixture driver and drill usage inside this report here. Now this is the key. You're going to use the handpiece if you're doing a URIS. I mean, they just give you the guides. They're going to help you with all of your cases. Switch to the ratchet in this case. Got your different offsets marked. so you know exactly the depth you're going through the guide, fully guided. You can align the black and gold slots, in this case, to the driver of the driver to the notch on the sleeves. And this is the timing. And this is how you get to do a custom healing abutment in this case. And they're just recommending that you use the path drill for accurate surgery. And here is their surgical guide. So the cost of this, if you want to delegate basically everything, you don't want to spend the time doing it, you're too busy, it's $150. Significantly less expensive than my previous workflow that I had zero control over. So now I've got the implant going in, the osteotomy. Now we switched over to the hand driver. And because of the timing, we can place this custom healing abutment to shape the tissue. Here's what that looks like. And here it is in the mouth, exactly how we planned it. And this is the same method you could use if you wanted to place a temporary crown or a tie base or pre-design a temporary restoration, because the implant's time, the final abutment really could also be made at the same time and seated. And here's a 3D image taken after placement. This is an older version of Romexus. Different screen. So here we are. We've waited several months of healing. We've removed the custom healing abutment. We're going to take a scan of the tissue, the stone model of the same. And then we go to the scan body tab. We just copy the pre-op scan over there, erase the tissue there and put the scan body in and scan that. And then here's the buccal view of that. So now here's the final custom abutment. Crown design. And then here it is in the mouth. Trying the abutment. Then the crown is tried in. Then I unscrew the abutment and seat the crown and abutment at the same time to make sure there's no problems inserting, you know, the line of draw issue. Then I cement the crown to the abutment extraorally in my hand. So we have zero cement retained below the gum line. So we've really reduced our risk of peri-implantitis. Here's the access hole. We place cotton and I put a little PTFE tape in there, usually a different color than white, blue, so I can easily see the difference if I need to remove the composite and get access to the screw. And then I just simply fill that with composite in the mouth. And that's what that looks like. So the restoration, you've already seen this, $25 for the scan body, $204 for the custom abutment and the crown design file, and $34 to mill that, $263. So this is if I'm buying the scan body, and this is if I already have the scan body, so $25 less expensive. So quite a big gap, and the digital is just so much easier and so much faster. Patients really prefer it. So you choose the workflow you want, choose the technology you want to use in your office. I really honestly don't care to ever restore an implant this way again. I don't know why, but open trays were stressful for me. There's stuff everywhere. Trying to uncover the screw, make sure I can have access to it. You've got extra cost, model fees, lab fees, analogs, impression material. TruAbutment and the CAD CAM workflow just really takes care of that. Here's a little website view of theirs to show you what they have, and you can go take a look around. This talks about their custom abutments, patient-specific, adjustable cement lines, very cost-effective. They have angulated screw channel, parts in the driver kit for that. We can't always get the placement we want, and that's a very nice thing to have. Multi-unit abutments. They call it All-NT. Locator case. They can help you plan all of these for you. Want to do a tie base or a true base, make a temporary restoration or even your final. And if you scroll through that list, basically, most likely the implant you use is going to be in there. Same goes with the scan body. Hybrid peak and titanium. $25. I have not yet had an issue finding a scan body for an implant that a specialist has sent back to me to restore. I just clicked on the BioHorizons because it's the first one on the list. You can see the different ones available. And they also have a CEREC solution. Compatibility chart for you. Drivers that you might need. And that's essentially their website. So I think we've covered all of our objectives. We know that guided implant placement is more predictable. The screw-mentable restoration is more predictable. Digital impressions are preferred by patients and by dentists. Turnaround time on TruAbutment workflow is faster, very fast. Digital workflow with TruAbutment lowers your overhead significantly, and it's really just easy. And thank you very much for your time and for listening. I hope you learned something. Thank you very much. Take care.
Thanks, Dr. Young, for the great webinar. And thank you to PlanMecaFit for sponsoring tonight's webinar. If anyone has questions about adding CAD-CAM technology to your practice, please email us at webinars@henryschein.com and we'll connect you with a representative in your area. Additionally, if anyone is interested in attending future Henry Schein webinars, visit henryscheindental.com/webinars for our upcoming schedule. Thank you all for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you on future webinars. Have a great evening.